Good afternoon, good evening, Trevor. It's a pleasure to have you here in Berlin. You had already some presentations here during the day, so I guess some of you maybe heard already about the struggle for the rights of workers in the in South Africa, in the farming sector, in the Cape Town province. Trevor is conducting with his trade union. I was privileged actually to meet Trevor last year in spring in Cape Town when we had a visit in the Robertson wineries, a factory which is producing wine. And there was a strike your trade union was organizing. And for me it was really impressive to see you there in front of the factory. We wanted actually to enter the factory to have a meeting with the shop stewards, but the management didn't allow us to enter the factory. So Trevor and his colleagues called with the mobile phone, and then a lot of colleagues came out from the factory to inform us about the working conditions in the Robertson factory. My question would be, Trevor, this strike action in Robertson, what did it mean for your trade union? And what did it mean also for you personally? I know that you were one of the founding members of the trade union, and it it was founded 10 years ago, or a number of, I think 10 years ago. So could you give us a glimpse about the strike and what was the significance for the trade union and for you personally?
Thank you very much, Boris, and thank you for having me here in Berlin. I hope people can understand my English. English is not also my home language. I'm an Afrikaans speaker, so bear with me. I think the Robertson Winery strike was quite significant and important in the sense that it exposed the working conditions of workers. But before I get there, it was also a strike that the union didn't want, because we were scared. Because you deal here with a very powerful wine conglomerate. And we were, in terms of the African terms, not a very big union. So it was for us a very, very difficult situation. And the bosses basically have said to us at the CCMA, the CCMA is the dispute resolution mechanism which deal with the dispute between the employer and the worker. And in that body, then the wage negotiations collapse. They said to us, if you want to strike, you can go. And we argue for basically that another 30 days extension, the parties can see how to resolve this. But the bosses insist that they don't have the money. We are irresponsible in demanding 8,500 and other demands. But we have a history in South Africa. We have a history. We, in the history, was set the stage when Nelson Mandela said, when he was in prison, that we either submit or we fight. And we base ourselves on that. It was either that we have to, if we have to, we must not show any weakness. We have to go. So, and workers have been striking basically. That strike hold for 3 months, and the employees have thrown everything at us. Private security, police, scare labor. They use the courts and want arguing the court that we should be detained because of violence, that we are taking violence. So it was quite, but we were quite determined. So we were like also calling for solidarity, because we have built quite a significant solidarity based in where the wines from wineries going, like in Sweden, in Norway, in other Scandinavian countries. So we're making use and appeal for the comrades to assist. So it opened up basically the window of solidarity. It strengthened the solidarity between the south and the north. And we have also learned a lot. We didn't know much about these wine monopolies. So the strike basically revealed to us in terms of this. And we also met a lot of new comrades from... but it also became very difficult for workers in that the significance that workers... you deal with very poor workers. So workers are basically between the wages protecting them from poverty. So to be 3 months and even 1 month on strike, it's extremely difficult for workers. So we have basically appeal for assistance, building solidarity, raising food. And that strike was taken note. Many, specifically in Norway, in countries there, take note of this battle of workers. And significant of this strike, it was like being nominated as a union that is fighting for the poor, and we were noting, we were nominated for the Artist Svensson Award in Norway. I didn't even know that this award exists, because why? we were not in the battle for awards, but this give us some platform. So, but we also learned that our weaknesses, what we cannot fight the powerful bosses alone, that we were not strong enough. We have to try to negotiate a settlement, even if we cannot meet the demands, because workers was getting restless and the potential for violence was on the increase. So we have basically in that context settled for quite less than we want, but it maintained our unity and our solidarity, because that was important for us, that we maintain the unity of the workers.
For me, this was very visible that your trade union built a lot of confidence with the workers in Robertson, and a lot of trust between the poor workers on the plantations and the union. So my question would be, this strike, how was the process in the years before? How did you build these links to the workers, many of the migrants from other parts of the country and even from other countries? So how did your union build up the organizational network which made the strike possible?
Yeah, thank you. You see, Kosovo was formed in 2006 as a union, and we as activists have basically see a need that we have to organize the most oppressive layer of workers in South Africa, because farm workers are the most oppressed. Under apartheid, farm workers was not allowed to join any unions because they were only there to work for their master, and that was that. So many have failed basically to organize farm after 1994. Many have failed. Even COSATU have made some attempts. Our intervention was like to learn from the workers. But it was also for us very personal, because it was people who looked like us. We have a generation of our parents coming from the farms, and many of us leaders family are staying on the farms. So we have a lot of meetings with workers around, like this is a fire like this, and we talk with workers. Workers engage us in terms, and we also have a lot of speak outs where we invite workers, hundreds of workers, to talk about their conditions so that we can learn. You see, and out of that was born 23 demands. And these demands purpose was to unite all workers, to build solidarity amongst the workers, but also to engage migrant workers. Our import was also the migrant workers. Mostly workers are coming from Zimbabwe and Mozambique and other African, Lesotho and other African states. So there was potential tension between the migrant workers and the South African workers, because the employers, the farmers, was using the migrant workers against the South African workers by employing them unless. So that created a lot of tension and created difficulties. So many South African workers were saying that they are taking our jobs and so forth and so forth. So we have to bring in the migrant workers. The only thing for us was to bring the migrant, all the workers inside the union. That we cannot just organize workers, we have to organize everyone, that means the family. And in the organization, people will see that they have one common interest and one common enemy. So that was important for us. We have formed migrant forums, women worker forums, because the most oppressive workers on the farms are women workers. So yeah, so it was that conditions that we have engaged in to ensure that we are intact with the workers on the ground. And then we make this announcement, like I said, we make this announcement that we have to, that if the conditions of the workers in the people of the farms are not going to change, there will be a bloodbath. We have made that statement because we could confidently make it because what we heard and experienced with the workers. And it happened in 2011, where there was a massive uprising amongst the poor, the first time in the history of South Africa, poor farm workers was standing up. And the demands that the workers put forward was basic human demands that people are not even thinking of, like clean water, like the dams will be protected, that our children, our lives are not in painted, a crest where our children can stay, transport, basic human demands. Not demands, the workers are not even demanding the farm. So that lead basically to the uprising, and we call it the uprising, because on South African TVs, it was like a revolution, and the rich and the powerful in the government did take note. The increase was 52%. Nowhere in the history, I don't think in the world history, have unions negotiated a 52% increase for workers. Money is still insignificant to sustain human life, but the fact is that it raised the confidence of the workers. And the only people that could understand that was the farmers. Many unions, what we have, didn't understand. We didn't look at the money, but at the confidence, because the poor have find confidence in themselves that they can do it. And we want to push that forward. Our task was to maintain that confidence and to push it forward.
For me, particularly striking was when some of the workers we met in front of Robertson told us that apartheid still exists. Although the apartheid system was smashed more than 20 years ago. What does it mean when they say apartheid still exists in Robertson?
Yeah. Amantla, yeah. You see, the fabric of society is still exists in terms of apartheid. You got only the boards that have gone, like whites here and blacks there. That's the only thing. But our view is that the CODESA negotiations, the negotiations that the ANC was involved in, they have betrayed the people. Because they have negotiated only political freedom, but not economic freedom. Because 85% of the land is still in the hands of 25,000 white farmers. You see, so the majority of our people don't have land. 92 of the riches of the JSE, the stock exchange, belong in still in white hands. So they still have power. You that have economic power, you control the politics, because what they would create is just a black middle class, a black rich, that have nothing to do with the transformation of the life of the African working class. You see, so what the workers are saying. In that factory, there's still separate toilets for white and black workers. There's still, and this is where it is illegal. That is, in terms of South African constitution law, it is illegal. A white mechanic is still earning more than a black mechanic. So the differences still exist. Black workers have to clock 3 clock systems, white workers only 1 clock system, you see. So the situation is still resembling apartheid situation that exists. Yeah.
How did you address this problem during the strike? Was it part of the demands to overcome these wage differences and the differences amongst white and black workers in Robertson?
You see, our demands was quite clear, that we need equality amongst all workers, between black and white workers, between male and female workers. All workers that that do the same job must earn the same wages. You see, so that demand was made clear. We have campaigned around, and we are still campaigning around. In terms of the agreement that we have signed with the company, that we will engage these issues further in the next year's negotiations. But there's a continuous campaign in struggle to ensure that we reap the benefits of this new South African democracy.
I want to ask you a little bit about your biography as a trade unionist and a political activist. You were born in 1963. So you were still living in apartheid times, also already starting to politically being active and engaged. If you look back from today's perspective, what was the moment you entered into activism? When did start? What happened to make you a rebel?
I don't know if I'm a rebel. You see, it's your condition that you lived in forced you. You don't have, it's not a choice. It's a condition that you were lived in. I can remember then I was a child of 7, 8 years old. I just recall a child. Then there was quite a beautiful park there. And our mothers, we stay in one house with my mother's sister, and they have children, and normally we are quite the same age, the sisters. So we normally want to go to that park to go play there. But we didn't know this, we don't look right. No? This park was only for white children. So I think there started my thinking, why can we not play there? They can play there, but we cannot play there. All that we want to do is to ride on the swings, to ride on the horse. But then we are chased by a white person with a dog, with a black dog. He got a black dog, in fact, chasing black kids. So it was, then we will run, we will lay, we will watch him, we'll go, and the white kids will call us, come there. Only after years I think about, and today then I go to that park and sit there, and I take my daughter to that park and say, there was one time that we couldn't play here at children. So, but it's also the question of that you see the suffering of the people, you see the how our mothers, our fathers was insulted by white supremacy. We have saw it, we see the fears for white people. So I became angry. I became angry. We also have to fight. In fact, I was classified as a colored person, not as a black person. I have to fight to be restored as a black person in the South African context, because the division, they also want to divide black people. So, and that also bring you in conflict with your own family. You are a better black. Why don't you want to accept that? No? So that division was even there amongst the. So this, I must go through all this type of frustration and thinking in terms of confronting what is happening. But it started at school, at high school, the 1980. Then we support our brothers and sisters at Khoza schools. We support of the that free education, better education, the same schools as the whites. Because that these were quite battles. Many children have died. We were shot at. I lost friends in that battle. So there was, and then there was another battle in 85. So all these struggles, you learn, and I've met some. In this struggle, you meet a lot of people with different political ideas. So I've met comrades that was representing the Marxist tendency in the ANC, with a tendency in ANC. I want to join the MK. I want to join the Umkhonto who sees where to take up arms. I want to, because at that time we were still a bit confused. Because all that we know is that we have to fight the white racist. You see, but then you go into discussions with the comrades. You also get confused and you get clear. You get confused and you get clear. What is this? It seems like these comrades are supporting the apartheid. In as you begin to understand, as I understand the limit of Marxist understanding. In how society works, how the system works, that this is not a race struggle, this is a class struggle. And I draw that conclusion, and must be quite thankful for these comrades that I could see that this is the capitalist state is using apartheid as a system to exploit the black working class. And they even said we must appeal to the white working class based on the class proposition, even if they are more racist. Because white workers tend to be more racist in South African context because of the position. So that we must all even appeal to the white. I couldn't understand that at the beginning, but I started to realize that it's important that we appeal to people on the class basis.
Could you give us maybe a little bit an idea how the political activism in an illegal organization looked like in that years? So what were you doing, and how did you do things? How did you organize concretely?
When we have organized, we call it cells. No? We've organized in cells. Like we didn't have like big meetings. We were comrades in small cells, like 4, 5, 6 comrades. And we have used different names. My name was Henry. So my job was to transport the pamphlets from one place to another place. Because it was illegal to even read a UDF or ANC pamphlet. So my job was to ensure that comrades get pamphlets from, we make the pamphlets in the, like we build links with the community. We have a photocopier in a house, in an ordinary house. We make photocopies there, then they must transport. You can talk about this now, but that time you were very nervous, you were very scared. Because you must go from Biavel Station to Cape Town Station. And in that time they call it the Kits Constables, the quick constables. If people that are getting mostly black, poor, that are being trained for a day or two, and then they got blue clothes, and they have to search you. And you have to pass 12 stations to go to Cape Town Station, and then you must sit there with these pamphlets. If they catch you, you go to Robben Island. So I was in, my comrade that was with me was also very scared. Then he was like walking, I said, you must sit still here, you see this police. So it was quite a difficult situation to organize in a illegal environment politically, because your parents and your brothers even don't know what you're busy with. So you couldn't put them in Bainza. Even after apartheid, I told my mother what I'm busy with. She said, is it? It's so they were quite taken by, they know that I was quite vocal in raising my views in terms of against apartheid system, but they didn't know that some of us were quite deeply involved in terms of spreading the word. So I have quite a low level job in the movement. Other people have much higher job.
You have a lot of knowledge about strategy, about tactics. You discussed many things. You were learning by doing. But to which extent you had also a let's say a more theoretical reflection of the things you were doing in the practical work of your political activism.
Man, personally, I've only at that time that I was at school, we call it standard 8, is now grade 10. So that was the formal education, so I can only read and write. But our real education was basically in the movement where we have called reading groups, where we will read some political articles of key political people like Lenin, Trotsky, Marxism. We will read it, we will discuss it, we will exchange our so it was a quite a period, and I think my education is there. My education is there, where we will, we have the slogan at that time, each one teach one. So we will teach each other. So that was for me an eye-opener. And even it is in conflict with the religion I was growing up. It confronted the religion. I know that meeting, I couldn't even participate in that meeting because it confronts something that I thought you should not. You see, basically at the time. But it even assists me to understand that religion also plays a major role in our oppression, you see, and the role that it played. So it also go through a stage where I severed my relation with the religion I've been grown up, seeing it as an oppressive way. And that also bring you in conflict with your family, specifically your mother and father, because I grow up in a quite, like I said, in a very humble family, very people that are religious, working class people that are basically there that we must have food, we must have education, but we must be confined, which they not realize, to the system. And that is what we were fighting to break at youth.
Could you describe us a bit your feelings during the time when apartheid was ended, when Mandela was elected president of South Africa? What were your expectations in that moment?
You see, I have a split. My brain was split. And the reason my brain was split at that time, because I was prepared in the Marxist tendency that the ANC government is not going to resolve the economic policy. So I was in a certain way prepared, because the slogan that we have spray painted on the walls during the night was "Build a mass ANC on a socialist program." That was going out. So, but even with that split, I was quite excited. It was quite excited. We were overwhelmed by excitement, because why? We will end basically white rule. You see, everyone, parents, everyone. So that's the only time I vote, and I vote for the ANC because there was excitement. The feeling of jubilation, the feeling of ending white rule. You cannot imagine what goes through people's mind. So, but there's also other side of it. There was also people that I grow up with that was thinking the opposite side. Because there was also, in terms of people that was classified as colored, not black. So many of these people was like fearing black rule on the other side. So it was also a contradiction in terms of some of us and there was a quite fights between, family members. Then they say that, then you ask them, "Oh, who are you going to vote?" They said, my vote is my secret. So if you say the vote is your secret, then you vote for the NP, the Nationalist Party. So we are saying we vote for the ANC. So there was, because there was a scare tactic that the Nationalist Party have propagated, that blacks will take our houses, they will rape our mothers, and all the type of crap that they were trying to say. But nevertheless, that for me, till today, it was an important event in the history of South Africa. But I constantly know that the ANC will not solve the problem of South Africa, and that is why we are still fighting.
So maybe, now it's more than obvious that the ANC has has a problem. I mean, with Jakub Zuma falling because of his corruption scandals and many other problems. What would you say today, from the perspective as a trade unionist, who is the force of social change in South Africa today? Is it the trade unions, or are there also other movements which could support the fight for more social justice?
You see, for me, the significant change in the South African political scene is the NUMSA resolution of 2013. NUMSA is the biggest metal union in South Africa. In terms of the NUMSA resolution to break from the alliance, from the ANC. And that is for us very significant. And for even for Kasawi, it was very significant because we were waiting, like we were waiting for an opening. Because we Kasatu didn't play that role anymore. The other federation didn't play that role anymore. The break with NUMSA, we immediately support that. And also the resolution of building a workers' party. So we fully support, we bring out a public statement that we support the NUMSA and we will assist for building a workers' party. So that event for us is significant that it put, it, like I said, it break the grip that the ANC have over us as working people because of its liberation credentials. So there is continue. So SAFTU to the new federation, for me is the new engine for change. But we're also very cautious. We're also very cautious because why? Many of these SAFTU leaders came from COSATU. You can leave COSATU, but they don't say you leave the menace. If that's the right English word I want to use, to leave the traditions of the organization. Because we were at the launch of SAFTU, and we were the only union in the significance of that meeting of SAFTU. The launch of SAFTU was that Kasavu, as a farm worker union, was the first time in the history that that farm workers was being represented. It's a big event. Now SAFTU is representing about 700,000 workers. So in that meeting, we make a very profile intervention and saying that we should break from high salary of union officials. No union officials who earn more than a skilled worker, because many of these union officials are getting the same salary as the CEOs. So that is where we have no union officials who have special privileges, because our union, I don't have special privileges. No one must have special privileges. The workers must decide. So I don't have to, in that context, haven't break from that. And that is where we as Kasavu want to make our contribution to give the warning. You see, so yes. But the Zuma, the another way that South Africa is going is was the 34 killing of the Marikana workers, the mine workers. We were shocked to the core of our being that it was on TV. We cried and we see that mine workers were shot by live ammunition. 34 mine workers have been shot. So it's quite clear that the ANC and the person who have been involved in that, who have instigate that, we believe, is the president of South Africa, Cyril Ramaphosa, because he was part of the directorship of the Lonmin mines. You see, so the killing of that mine workers was a significant change in the still change where I think what we are seeing new things developing, and the emergence of a workers' party is we hope it will come before 2019. I may sound contradictory, but we are also concerned about this workers' party that was built in the confines of the NUMSA offices. So that is our concern, because we believe a workers' party must be built in struggle. You see, workers' party must be built in struggle. So there is that dangers in terms of our understanding where these movements are moving, but we believe that the ANC have finished. The EFF, comrades have heard of the EFF, of Julius Malema. I have some sympathy. You ignored Julius on your own. in terms of the land question that is confronting South Africa. So South Africa is moving, it's going through significant, it's dangerous, but also exciting times. But a new movement will develop. Is developing.
Maybe as a last question, the international solidarity campaign to end apartheid was quite an important moment for the international left movements. How is it today? What do you expect from the international left to support the struggles today in South Africa? And in which terms you see a possibility of common struggles also? What would be your idea how an international left could link up with the current struggles in South Africa?
I don't know. But what we are doing now in Kasavu is in terms our founding was based that we cannot build any organization without international solidarity. Because the system is international. Our struggle must be international. The oppression of the working people are international. So we have to build these type of links. We have to, in terms of the wine industry, we must follow the bottle of wine. Maybe the wine is on the table there, you see. And we must build links. And we have built links basically in many of the Scandinavian countries. We have built very strong links, like in Sweden, in Denmark, in Norway. And because of our battles, the Norwegians have seen the liberty to award us the Artist Svensson Award, which put us in a position to appeal more for international solidarity. We have made contacts with workers around the world in the Philippines, in Indonesia, in Argentina, in Chile, and we have built quite strong solidarity links with workers everywhere. Still a battle, and I think the Rosa Luxemburg and the IUF are organizing a international meeting of farm workers in October in South Africa, where I'm part of the steering committee in here to organize for that event. So yes, from our side, small scale, it must be a religion, international solidarity, you see? And that basically is with our building of solidarity, it's put us in a position where the employees will have more respect for you. They have more respect in terms of them they engage with you, because it gives you some power. The national is give you more power to get more out of them.
Okay, Trevor, many thanks for this conversation. I think also your struggles are giving a lot of power to us here. So it's a mutual exchange of creating a better position for the struggles. Thank you very much for being here in Berlin. I wish you success. Also on Monday we will have a meeting to prepare this international conference. So we as a Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung are really happy to cooperate with such a fantastic movement which you are a part of. Thank you very much.